come on board for this new flight to Luxembourg Income Study Research and Data Center Program. So we have today double presentation. The first part of my session will be devoted to the question of inequalities between birth cohort and generations. I just test my screen and writing tool, and we'll discuss on the first session about birth cohort and inequalities. You will have access to the different documents there and there, and you will see on the chat discussion too. For latecomers, you have a link, a direct link to the different documents you could need. That's it. Just to have a very short presentation of what I do, I am professor of sociology in the University of Luxembourg. I'm a long-term specialist of inequalities. At some point, at age 23, I left econometry and economics for sociology, but I went there with my toolbox of distributional analysis and different subtools. So my main domain inequalities, generations, for instance, generations and suicide rates, is one of my favorite topics. I work a lot on income and wealth distribution, and this will be the topic of the second session of the day after 3:45 Luxembourg Continental European time. I work a lot also on non-linear socio-historical change, and I try model non-linear dynamics in sociology, and I'm extremely interested in phenomena of disruptions in socioeconomic trends, and I work a lot on middle class dynamics. Anyway, for this first part of this first session A today, for a bit less now than 1 hour and a half, be aware that my main will be about cohort inequalities. And we'll have three parts. The first one, very rapidly, will be devoted to the theory of cohort dynamics and inequalities. The second part will be devoted to the methodology of age period cohort transformation. And the third topic will be an important aspect, that is, can generate different types of imbalances between birth cohorts with obvious disruptions in some countries in terms of level of living of younger generations. So I will try follow the Q&A, but if you see important domain, important topics you would like to see, do not hesitate to interact, even if Zoom is not the most interactive place. So just to begin with, the first topic about birth cohort dynamics is intersecting with a very important domain of social policies discussions and also political discussions regarding imbalances or ruptures between generations. And if you read the press, the FT, Guardian, or whatsoever, the question of sacrificed generation is a permanent topic everywhere. It intersects with the question of is the millennials generation at risk of deprivation, of systemic deprivation? And my domain is at first social science and not politics. So I will try underline the importance of this topic of social generations and birth cohort analysis in the social sciences. To be very short, because time is not massively abundant, we'll see those different people in the coming slides. It's a very long domain. I mean that the first in this list, 1928, Karl Mannheim, is a very important theorist of sociology and social sciences, interested in how historical disruptions could participate in the creation of different social generations. It's a very important text translated in English. You will see that. I will very rapidly underline the importance of Margaret Mead, who developed a kind of theory of generation 1968, the socio-political generation at age 20 in 1968 in Berkeley, in Paris, in Beijing and elsewhere. But I will insist much more on Glenn Elder, And then we will enter in the hardball econometrics of birth cohort dynamics and analysis with the latest one. So we have no time to insist on the importance of Margaret Mead or Karl Mannheim. Be aware that those different texts are available through the links you will find on the PowerPoint I circulate. Do not hesitate to make use of this. It's funny, this status of this text of David Card, labor economist in Berkeley, is not so important, but it fits with Margaret Mead in the reality, and this text is more methodological. I repeat that I will not dig too much in the direction authorization of birth cohort dynamics and generational arguments, the social generations argument that fit with that, serve the massive disruption, historical disruption between before First World War and after First World War in Germany. It's a very important text, The Theory of Generations. It shows how civilizational transformations, brutal civilizational transformations, can generate extreme divergence between birth cohorts that are born relatively close one to another. Typically, Karl Mannheim was born in 1890-something, so he was, with his age group, he was supposed to participate in the First World War, and generations born a bit later have had very complex relations with politics in Germany. But I have no time, I repeat, to insist on that, but it's a very important text to read and know to understand how socialization can change the context of society. So all those texts will be available through copy-paste of the links or in the drive. Second important text, but we have no time to develop. It's typically Theory of Generation 1968, that was 20 years old in 1968, and the complexity of this disruption in politics that was not only for Western European countries and the US, but almost everywhere on the planet. Anyway. What we'll insist more in methodology is on the text that you have right, Norman Ryder, who was one of the first to develop, to systematize the analysis of social change through birth cohorts, people who are born the same year or relatively close year one to another, and Glenn Elder, who is a qualitative sociologist, developed a very important book in 1974, and the last chapter that had been added in 1999 is a very important text in the domain of the social science of birth cohort transformations. It's qualitative, but he had been able to develop panels of analysis. We have no time to go too far in that direction, but beware, this book is extremely important to understand generational disruptions that happen for the generations born in the early 1920s in the US, in particular in Oakland, Berkeley. Beware that this important book is available in tlib.org. Okay, I'm not sure that I'm entitled to speak of this link. Tlib is something like a copyleft and not completely legal place to access 5 million books. Do not make use of this link from your university at home. It's better. So you have understood that this book is important and you can find it somewhere in the space. The most important aspect of the domain of age period cohort analysis and the understanding of social change through birth cohorts being people born the same year, if you want, is based on this rapid scheme that is expressed in Mannheim and elsewhere. So general idea is that if you consider the life course of young people, you have a specific period of frailty between early adulthood to stabilization in adult life after PhD, maybe, I'm not sure, it's family or whatsoever. But the general model you have in the literature is that during primary socialization, people are protected by their parents and by school to external influences. Secondary socialization happens when people are stabilized in long-term adulthood. And you have a specific time of transitional socialization when, if you have important individual events during this period of transition, your destiny, your fate can change and take another direction. For instance, if you're interested in politics, it's clear that it's important to meet an important leader in politics in this window of transitional socialization. Or it's important to find a kind of beruf, of vocation to do something, artist whatsoever, geniuses and so on, find their way in general in this period of transitional socialization. Be aware that it's true at the individual level. If you find the best possible partner during that time, this could change your destiny. In the opposite case, it could be opportunities for disruption. So this scheme had been thought initially for individuals, but it's true also at collective levels. I mean that for a complete generation that is 20-something at some point, it's clear that if at some point you have, let's say, economic acceleration and many new opportunities, like in 1968, this transitional socialization could be particularly propitious, cool, nice. But of course, for generations that face transitional socialization in a period of massive war, revolution, socio-economic decay, or global pandemic, it's clear that if massive disruption into the socioeconomic trends affect the population, the general population, those who are at age 20 and face those kind of events could be at particular risk of transformation of their set of opportunities. The general idea is that before age 18, the set of opportunities are somehow stabilized by parents, school, etc. And in long-term adulthood stabilization, new sets of opportunities change slowly. But when you have a disruption, those in transition are particularly frail and at risk of exposition to collective traumatism. It's why we speak of scarring effects, for instance, in labor economics. You have a huge discussion about scarring effects or scar effects after period of mass unemployment for the young generation. I think of Elwood 1982. You will find those references in the usual literature. It's something of particular importance. So the general idea is that when some specific strong event happens, the population at age 20-something is the first to be traumatized and could generate a very specific situation. Simply to go back to the children of great Glenn Elder, that is big classical, I insist on that, that generation born in the early 1920s faced the consequences of American participation in World War II. It's not only being a kid during economic depression, it's also the transformation of set of opportunities of 20-somethings in the early 1940s. And then for those who had been able to survive scars, traumatism, those who benefited from resilience and recovery, the survivors of that generation Elder was interested in benefited from massive, strong social policies we call the GI Bill of Rights. That was a policy devoted to veterans of the Second World War. And this GI Bill of Rights had been an opportunity for former soldiers to have access to more education, better positions of as civil servants in the state organization, etc. Of course, we'll see that the GI Bill of Rights policy was not neutral on gender inequalities, simply because pro-veterans policies are also extremely genderized and unequal. We'll see that in terms of generations. So, part two of this presentation his methods. I warn you that I will have no time to enter in all the details, simply because it's relatively complicated, elaborated literature. Just to begin with, beware that as a demographer and sociologist, my main identity now, even if it's age period cohort is a question of demographers and sociologists, quantitative sociologists, beware that for economists, and at some point, you have important literature in economics regarding age period cohort models. In this paper of Angus Deaton and Christina Paxson, one Nobel Prize, one president of Ivy League, Brown University, super big economist in super serious journal, as you see, these age period cohort models are not only econometrics for demographers, you have also a strong literature in economics, even if for demographers, you have much stronger literature. So be aware that in this reference is used by economists, but in demography, you have much better. What is the idea of age period cohort analysis, of birth cohort analysis? It's a synonym. It's something that comes from demography, where typically, as soon as you have cross sections across periods of time, if you have age groups, so different slices of time, of period you have here with different age groups from age 0, 10, 20, 30, etc. You have age on the vertical axis. Time, period, years, for instance, on the horizontal axis, years. So Y is not Y, but years. When you have A and P, the diagonal times you can detect here represent different cohorts of birth. People who are born the same year, but you can have yearly data or data set each fifth year. But when you have this possibility to have series of cross-sections each, for instance, third year on the horizontal axis, and if you can cut the age distribution of the population in groups of 3 years, you will see in diagonal different birth cohorts. For instance, those who are born in 1894 or the lucky people who were 20 in 1914, for those who are born in France or Germany in 1894, you will see that 50% of that generation disappeared. And with this Lexis diagram, you can detect how a specific age group in a specific period, also a group of individuals that are born the same year. So we have perfectly rigid relation between age, period, and cohort. Age of someone is period minus birth cohort. It is something extremely, extremely clear. Before we enter in econometrics, be aware that this is not a LISI program. It's a program that you can make use on your local Stata software. You can simply copy-paste this program to have a nice heat plot representing the distribution. So this line will open a data set of veterans coming from the American Current Population Surveys extracts. And then what you could have here, indeed, it's not true. It's something like 2 million individual copy-paste problem. Provided that you select only male population in the age groups 25 to 85, this line is not useful immediately. Beware that you will have to unstar these lines if you don't have those different Stata packages, APCD, APCGO, or things I have developed in the University of Luxembourg in the recent years. Heatplot is a super cool package of Stata, Stata command. Heatplot is able to make nice graphs with colors. You must load also palette and color space, something like that, that are additional packages you will need. And this very simple set of instructions will give you this graph. What is this graph? It gives the percentage of veterans in the male population between the red category, 77% of veterans in this age period group, and in blue, it's less than 10% veterans in these age groups. And what you see when you have this Lexis graphic with period horizontal from the 1960s to recently, and if you have the age groups between age 25 to almost 80, what do you see with the heat map? You see a specific diagonal group, the cohort born a bit before 1925, between 1920 and 1925, who are typically the participants to World War II. This generation here later is the Korea War generation. And in green here, we are still at 1/3 of veterans. It is the Vietnam War generation. So those born in 1945, close to this diagonal arrow I have here, or the Vietnam War generation. And then you have a strong decline of veterans, percentage of veterans. In the old generations, cohorts born here to 1905 were born too early to participate in World War II and too young to participate in World War I. So you have the same observation. So interest of this kind of descriptive analysis, you can do almost the same thing in LISI, is to have a pure descriptive vision of what is in the birth cohort or not. Typically, with veterans, it's relatively easy to understand that if at age 20, you participated in the Second World War, 20 years later, at age 40, you will have a veteran status. So this veteran category membership is something that is attached to your birth cohort. And opportunities, opened opportunities to participate in wars, for instance, is clearly attached to socioeconomic and political and global context when you are 20-year-old, 20-something. And those examples were the first to give different colleagues the econometrics of age period cohort. On the following slides, beware that I give you certainly too much to be presented. Simply beware that in this set of maybe 5 slides, you have long series of papers, and it's not a complete bibliography, beware of that, where different colleagues tried to develop and improve age period cohort models. In the University of Luxembourg, we are one of them interested in detecting how age period cohort analysis of suicide rates, obesity, mortality at large, etc., could be relatively important to understand socioeconomic transformation. At the end of this first session, we'll go closer to this paper with Martin Schroeder on socioeconomic improvements and difficulties in different welfare regimes. So I have no time to develop on this literature. You have this PowerPoint. If the topic is interesting for you, be aware that it's a very rich literature. I have a question, sorry, 25 years ago. Could you explain? It's in the Q&A. I did not see this. So could you please explain what the diagonal elements stand for again? Diagonal elements here are very clear. If you are, for instance, 40 in 1965, this means that you are born in 1925. If you are 75 in almost 2000, this means that you are also born in 1925. And the diagonal element means you are born such year and not another. And in this respect, it's a way to detect immediately. I don't know if we must speak of sacrificed generation or whatsoever generation, but the social generation that participated in Second World War is typically here because older generations were too old to participate in the Second World War, and younger generation could not. The diagonals in the Lexis diagram represent cohort groups, and this APC literature is devoted to the econometrics of those transformations. So to make the story, the methodological story, very short, there is a general, very problematic, difficult issue in age period cohort analysis. We call that the identification problem. The identification problem is, once again, age of someone is period of observation of age minus his or her birth cohort, A equal P minus C. So the issue when you try detect an age effect associated with aging, a period effect associated to long-term year-based transformation and cohort effect due to cohort transformation, there is a problem of identification. I precise this problem of identification is a problem of identification of the linear trend. So if you have a linear trend of age transformation, with veteranship and with education, the linear trend associated with aging in general can be neglected. Above age 25, people with a bachelor's degree remain with a bachelor's degree. After age 25, former soldiers or still soldiers, etc., etc., etc. So if you have a linear trend on age, a linear trend, for instance, of economic growth on period, and a linear trend of socioeconomic transformation, for instance, more diploma, so higher skilled job, the problem with the age equal P minus C calculation is that the linear identification of age effect, period effect, and cohort effect are impossible. A priori, impossible, but if you have a strong hypothesis on the transformations. So, for instance, for diploma, if you know that age transformation is flat, you can identify the period and the cohort effect because of this table, age effect of diploma ownership or of veteran membership. In that case, the linear trend can be identified. If not, it's extremely complicated. So it's why we have developed a specific program, ESSC Install APCD program, that is non-linear detector. Indeed, the APCD model that suppresses the linear trend on age, period, and cohort is a kind of bump detector to detect non-linearities, that is disruption in age, in period, and in particular in cohort transformations, and typically with diploma and also with veteran membership. What we are interested in, for instance, are the non-linearities on the coefficients associated with birth cohort membership. Each gamma C is a specific year of birth. And this model with two sets of important constraints that are this and that. The idea of this coefficient is the sum of cohort coefficients is zero, and the slope of birth cohort coefficient is flat. If you have those two constraints on top of the other constraints on age and period, the model is able to detect the degree to which there are birth cohort non-linear fluctuations, and this model is able to provide estimates of the coefficients and standard errors. And if computation of standard errors is difficult, you can bootstrap to validate this possibility. Once again, there is a link associated to this. And on your local software, Stata 15, 16, 17, whatever, you will have help APCD to have to dispose of different examples. So I will not insist more. The syntax is very traditional in the sense that you have the command. You can put the dependent, the outcome variable, such as, for instance, income or log income or whatever. You can put a series of control variables, you can restrict your sample to different age groups or gender groups or whatever. You can make use of different weighting strategies. For instance, p-weight provide reliable standard errors. Frequency weight is used in general if you have count variables such as suicide, mortality, etc. So you have to precise your age variable, your period variable, and on top of that, you have many different specifications. For instance, something very common in mortality or suicide rates, when you have, typically, you have the possibility to generate Poisson models. You have, of course, the Gaussian OLS-style APCD model, but you can also, if you have family bin for binary, B-I-N, if you have family bin and logit for the link name, this is for APC logit specification style that you could generate. Once again, with your local stata, in 2 seconds, we switch to LISC on the PDF you have elsewhere, you will obtain this. I first insist on APCD. So what do you have here? Veteran membership is zero. So vet is a dummy variable, one for those who participated in a former war, and zero for non-veterans. So bin and logit, what do you have here? It's simply the... I see a question from Carlotta in the question and answer. I have no time to expose entirely the APCD model. It had been published several times. You will see that the linear hyperplane of age and period are absorbed by two linear coefficients you have here. This means that the alpha, p, and gamma age, period, and cohort coefficients fit the variation, the non-linear variation, detrended without the linear trend, detrended on the different age, period, and cohort coefficients. In that case, for veterans, the most important thing is birth cohort. It's what I graph here. You have different indicators to assess to which cohort can be an important or not so important variable in the age, period, and cohort variation. We have different indicators to do so. And the interesting thing is that we have big data sets. What you have here is the estimate and the 95% confidence interval uncertainty on the estimator. So you see that with 3,000 individuals in the data set, our data are relatively precise. And what you see is that you have a boom in veteran membership, of course, for the cohorts born in the early 1920s. This boom here is more for officers and the top general officers in the army in general. And the late comers born in 1925 are typically Private Ryan and other participants. So the logic of the APCD is that the sum of the cohort coefficients are thought to be zero. The argument is above and below zero. And the linear trend of the coefficient is flat. This means that those born before 1920 are below the line, and those born after 1950 something are above the line. Here you have World War II participants. Here it's the Korea War, and here it's the Vietnam War participants. People born in 1948 are typically those who were in age, in a specific age to participate in a Vietnam War. We have developed a second type of model, APCT lag, because sometimes in some specific problems, it could be interesting to have a clear vision of the linear trend. And we have developed this for education, veteranship, and different cases where we have strong hypotheses regarding the age effect over time. So with this APCT lag, we have the possibility to identify a trend over the birth cohorts. And then the logic of the zeros and the positive and of the negative values is an intensity of participation. The topic is for those born here to 1925. The local bottom is 1905. And in the recent years, you have a smaller and smaller legit, let's say, proportion of veterans in the younger generations. What is the difference between APCT lag, APC trended with lag age estimation? The difference between the two is that on APCD, the coefficient line is flat. On APCT lag, you can have linear trend. And this, the dotted line you have here, is simply the straight line you have here. The one and the other, it's not a homothetic transformation. It's simply a kind of rotation, if you want. So what we have in the toolbox for age period cohorts that we have implemented in different contexts with Luxembourg income study is the first one, APCD, the standard model for the detection of non-linear disruptions of bumps, if you want, in dynamics. Second, APCT lag is when you want to fit relevant linear trend in context where you know what is the age effect, it is feasible. We have developed also APC gap ORAK, APC GO, that is an age period cohort model that is able to detect the distance between two groups. For instance, incomes of men and women, birth cohort by birth cohort, to detect the degree to which gender inequalities are increasing or declining after the control with other variables. And the ORAK model is able to express the unexplained part of a gap between men and women, for instance, in terms of generational birth cohort-based gaps. We have an additional model, APC hysteresis, that is able to detect the degree to which birth cohort effect that is strong at the entry in adulthood is stable or declining or even increasing through follow-up of the degree to which lucky birth cohort continue to be luckier and luckier, and unlucky birth cohort diverging from the average dynamics of cohorts. This could be a case of increasing gap over age groups, cumulative advantage and disadvantage, if you want. But I have no time here to develop on these families of age period cohort models that have a great diversification. So part three is devoted to the implementation of program with age period cohort in the context of LIS American dataset. What is this horror? From 1974, the initial dataset without, before selection of bachelor's degree honors is 3 million participants in the dataset. And when you select bachelor's degree honors, you have almost 1 million individuals in the dataset. What is the idea of this model we'll implement in LICI is what is the gender ratio of bachelor's degree honors over time and period and cohort in the US. So we create a dummy variable that is gender ratio, one for female and zero for male, and you have gender balance if, for instance, bachelor's degree honors or 50-50 have gender ratio of 0.5, it's a gender balanced level. In logit, you know the logit transformation, the log of p divided by 1 minus p. In logit terms, you have gender balance when the logit is close to zero. It's relatively convenient. So what we do is APCD to see the transformation of the gender ratio with the detrended model, and then the same thing with the trend. So balance is when mean gender ratio is 0.5, and the program is available here. It is on the Google Drive box. It's also on this link you have here. If you simply want to implement it, you click here. You open do file. It's a LICI do file. Control A for selection. Control C to copy. You then run to web there. I do that with you. Project Luxembourg Income Study, package Stata, and subject. And then you paste the program and you can execute. And you will receive the answer there in 3 minutes, something like that. So what do we have in this program? What is in the do file? For you, it's not entirely new because in the two previous days, you have, yeah, clear all is stupid because it's a kind of a local Stata habit. Set abrev on is very important because it gives you the possibility to call, for instance, it gives you the possibility to abbreviate names of variables and instructions. Set abrev on is very useful. I always put this kind of instruction. This instruction will give you the beginning time. This gives you the stamp of time in your program. Stamp of time, we have 30 minutes before the break. So, LIS use, you know this instruction. We open the dataset from LIS from the very beginning of the American dataset. We select some variables. So, I took too much. We have ethnic, we have health. It's much too much. Personal, and then household variables. With Jörg, 1 year ago, Jörg in Luxembourg Income Study developed this LIS use program, and it had been a strong revolution for all of us. We hear it's a trick to have a kind of continuous year. If you have missing years, this is a way to fill the missing years. You have a continuous year. Indeed, it's a discrete year that will spread each year in 5 years. It's a dark magic tricks that is useful sometimes. If year is above 2020, we order it 2019. We generate year in 5 groups. We generate age in 5 groups. We select specific age groups between 25 to 79 year old population. Here, we prepare ed one, that is education. It's stupid to select subgroup of years of, sorry, variables. Here, it makes no sense. I suspect it will generate a mistake because I'm not sure we have ISO 3 year. ISO is international standard code for country. We have ISO 2, but ISO 3 is out. But this program works. I have tested it several times. So that's it. So we continue to do different things. We create weight that is compatible with frequency weights. Stata doesn't want non-discrete frequency weights. It's a bit stupid, but we have to survive that. And those two lines are a way to survive that. We generate C5, that is birth cohort in 5 year groups, year 5 minus age 5. We prepare 2 variables for the estimate and the standard error of the estimates. And then we continue. This is a trick to have the maximum and minimum birth cohort year in the max and min year. Here, at last, we select people with a bachelor's degree. Our objective is to see the gender balance within the group of bachelor's degree owners. So gender ratio is sex equal to. And this variable will be average 0.5 in case of balanced gender ratio. And then what we do here is on APCD with legit specification of gender ratio by we could control by different things, but we don't at this point. If you want to control with different variables such as household size or I don't know what, you can put it here. You will have just to unstar APCD lag if you want to make use of the program with a trend. And this series of instruction is to retrieve the estimates. In EB, we generate a matrix where we retrieve the estimates, and we also retrieve the variance covariance of the estimates in E uppercase V. And here we generate a tricky confidence interval size. Then here is a table of the estimates and confidence intervals, 95%. And here is a graph. And with the graph export instruction, we'll have the graph. So you just have to go to recent jobs. The most recent one is this one. what you have, it's traditional in LISI. The job text, the listing where it's important to track for problems, to search for problems, where are the errors or in the program. We know that the stamp at the beginning of the program was at 257 something, and the program ended at 3 p.m. and 5 seconds. So we know this program is only 3 minutes. It's the fastest one. And beware that with the graphs here, you have this graph. And what is the meaning of this graph? It's an APCD. Beware of that. I go back to the slides. So in the slides, what you have is first the estimate for the linear trends available. I repeat, we estimate the gender ratio of bachelor's degree owners. It is a sample of almost 1 million people. So it's people with a bachelor's diploma there. So you have a constant and you have the trends, the linear trends for age and cohort. And here, the thing that we find interesting is the coefficients for cohort from birth cohort 1900 to those born in 1985 to 1989. So you have the age effect, almost nothing. Here, what you have is women die later, in particular in the bachelor's degree honors category. So you have a better gender ratio for those age 75 year old, simply because male population dies earlier, not everyone. And the period effects are almost nothing once again. When we graph the APCD gender ratio, what do we see? Is before World War I veterans, the gender ratio in the US of bachelors and non-bachelors owners was to the advantage of women. The GI Bill of Rights represented a massive disruption in the declining percentage of women with bachelor's degree. The coefficient you have here is the logit coefficient that you can retranslate in percentage with the inverse logit function. After those born in 1920, you have relative linear increase and recovery for women. And in the recent birth cohort, more or less recent indeed, you have more women with bachelor's degree than male population. On top of that, you detect here non-linearity. This non-linearity is Vietnam War, the end of Vietnam War generation. What happens indeed? The GI Bill of Rights is free access to university for former soldiers. And when you read the literature on the GI Bill of Rights, it had been thought as a really machist, anti-feminist policy. Even women who participated in the Second World War, like military, nurses, and administration, whatever, were excluded from the GI Bill of Rights. And it was not participation in fights. Male in the administration received their GI Bill of Rights, and women had a specific status of civilian excluded from the GI Bill of Rights. So with the Vietnam War, when the GI Bill of Rights is really over, you have a small effect of recovery for women on top of the linear recovery you have here. And the main aspect of time disruption is the GI Bill of Rights. Be careful, it's an APCD detrended estimate. This means that this detrended estimate doesn't exactly mean women were advantaged before birth cohort 1910, if you want. APCD gives a zero slope, no linear trend family of cohort coefficient. To validate the trend, better or worse in terms of gender ratio, zero here is a perfect 50-50 balance between men and women. The APCD lag is able to detect the trend transformation. What do you see is that in older birth cohorts born in the beginning of 20th century, you have a relatively large confidence interval because the size of the sample is not infinite. but confidence intervals after are very clear. You have an extremely significant decline of women percentage in bachelor's degree owners away from the male dominance is here, and the role of the GI Bill of Rights is obvious. Here you have the end of Vietnam War. Here you have the linear trend of recovery for women, plus relative dominance now of women in the bachelor's degree honors category in the US. And now the trend is stabilizing at logit coefficient 0.2. You can retranslate this with the inverse transformation. That's it. So it's a way, epicity lag, with LISI, or a way to detect, for instance, gender ratio imbalances and disruption in the trend that is relatively easy to implement. Just to finish, after I will try to do the Q&A questions. Anyway, beware that the same technologies are extremely useful to identify, in comparison, the degree to which different welfare regimes had been able to give more or less opportunities to different birth cohorts in terms of sacrifice of some generations and the generations of lucky generations, and how other welfare regimes had been able to smooth the inequalities between generations. And in my case, I prefer welfare regimes. Okay, Louis, which assumption on the age effect do you apply here? I guess it's, once again, like Carlotta, a question regarding what we do with the age linear part of the in the model. I repeat, in the APCD, the strategy is to clean, suppress, and pre-identify whatever is linear in the age, the period, and the cohort model. It's an hyper plan of two dimensions in the space of three dimensions, a priori dimensions three, absorb this hyper plan. And what remains to be identified is non-linear slope zero variations. Now, for the APCT lag, it's published in the paper with Eyal Barheim, Anne Hartung, and myself in Higher Education. It's a paper about educational inflation, so typically something that you could find interesting. Petra, do I have direct link to this paper? I can try have it in 2 minutes. That is High Education, Barheim Chauvel. I remember it's SSC install. So in the chat, I copy-paste for you the paper that precises what we do to the age effect in the APCT lag model. Rapidly, the idea is that we observe on the window of age period cohort, we observe the average linear age transformation from one period to the next in average on the window of observation. And then this average trend is a constraint, is a linear constraint we implement to the age effect. When you're on education or veteran participation or that kind of variable, the average age effect on the Lexis diagram on the window of observation is close to zero. So it's relatively easy. If the trend is not zero, we put as a constraint on the age effect the aging effect we observe empirically on the window of observation from one period to the next for a given birth cohort in average. I'm not sure it's very my explanation. My oral explanation is super clean, but in the chat, you have the paper to this APCT lag based paper that is useful to understand, for instance, diploma inflation. The question being, when a diploma is more common, is the diploma declining in its value? It's something we did also with Luxembourg Income Study, if you want. So the idea of this paper is to understand non-linear fluctuations of cohorts in different countries. Here you have 17. What we are going to do is 12 countries and different types of countries. This paper can be refreshed 6 years after. What is the idea? You know, any kind of French sociologist is addicted with Durkheimian theorization and methodology. Only comparison affords the explanation. It's why Luxembourg income study is cool, because you can compare many countries. And the idea is to see the degree to which welfare regimes described and typologized by Gösta Espinger Andersen with different cohort regimes of inequalities. So what I will precise the point, we know in the French case that at the beginning of economic slowdown in the late 1970s, 1980s, you have had an insiderization of relative senior workers and an outsiderization of new entrants. And those new entrants are typically women, migrant workers, and of course, young generations entering the labor market in the context of mass unemployment, when the previous generations benefited from full employment at the entry in the labor market. And the idea is that the French Bismarckian welfare regime is able to frost the different statuses of the stable generations and the precariat generation. And due to different transformations, the stable generation is able to earn more and the precariat generation earns less. So we have no time to elaborate. You know this literature of Gösta Espinger Andersen. It's not brand new because this book has something like 30 years now. It's early 1980s, if I'm not wrong for the data. Early 1990s for the publication. It's more than 30 years old. But this had been refreshed by different books and all those books available in good university libraries. And if not in Zelib, I should not pronounce this thing. The model had been refreshed less than 10 years ago by Martin Schroeder here. And this paper by Emanuele Farragina and Martin refreshes the model. I will not insist. You have the liberal welfare regime based on market. And if someone is too expensive, you sell him or her and you buy two poor precariat people. And rapidly, you have a balance between different age groups in terms of rebalancing values of work of different age groups based on their productivity. On the social democrat welfare regime, you have collective bargaining to balance different difficulties. And in the corporatist welfare regime, typically France, Germany, whatever, this welfare regime is based on insiders who arrived in a correct socioeconomic situation or lucky enough to hold the best positions. And I simplify the model. I'm not like that in the reality, but due to time shortage, I cannot elaborate more politely the idea. And in the corporatist welfare regimes, young workers who enter too late to benefit from full employment and economic acceleration have to wait very long. They just have to take a glass of milk and wait for 10 or 20 years before redistribution of positions. And when redistribution of positions happen, they're too old to benefit from the redistribution of positions. Okay, I synthesize those ideas in this slide. I just precise that the Italian familialistic welfare regime model is even worse than the French model, with extreme exclusion of the young in Italy and Spain and that kind of thing. This slide is not entirely up to date. What we model is log equivalized disposable household income. The LEDI, if you want. So LEDI is the log equalized disposable household income, equalized by number of consumption units in the household. It's a traditional way we do in Luxembourg income study. We have many variables, not only age, period, and cohort, plus the LEDI. We have some controls, but in this paper, I have no time to show in this presentation, refresh of the paper with Martin Schroeder. We have no time for controls. And the question is, how birth date is associated to better or worse situation. The French case is very well known, where 60 plus age group, 60 plus people benefited from relative increase of their relative position of something like 15%, and those born too late declined in relative income hierarchy. Here is a log level of living per consumption unit, and zero is what is expected in the model where we suppose lack a no change in the age distribution of income. So this is the residual of what would happen if there had been no change in the age group. And what you see is that from 1980 to 1985 to 2000 to 2005 to 2010, this cohort that was 40 in 1985 and that is going older was almost systematically at the top of the distribution of income. So we can model that. You can take example two. You will find example two in the drive, the Google Drive, or copy paste on this link. You will find this link on the chat. So simple idea is, once again, you can example two. You replace the program here. You launch the program. I will rapidly comment what you have on the program. On the program, you have a selection of four countries: France, Finland, Italy, the US, from 1975. You can have the choice. I make use of this series of instructions simply to exclude in France 2010 the remote islands of French colonies, if you want, simply because in the first years you did not have Madagascar, La Réunion, etc., etc. So, and in 2010, it's specific, you have the remote islands of France, and this increases the Gini index and whatever. So I exclude those regions, and we don't have Germany in the data set, but I do the same with Eastern German new lander in Germany, simply because those new lenders arrive in 1995, into 1990s, if you prefer. And to have a stability of France and Germany, I implement this. So it's a way to exclude France. I should have suppressed the different save and use lines that could be useful. I generate a CCYY variable on this base so that we can copy-paste this. We can make use of PPP translated values. It's not useful for APCD, but when you make use of APCD lag, this line is useful to have stable price PPP translated, PPP 2017 translated variable. And then here we prepare the data set like in the first example in terms of age groups and period and country. Indeed, you have country ISO 2. ISO 2 is for countries. We then have to generate disposable household income PPP variable that we then equalized by the square root of people in the household. We have the log. And the log is ready to make use. We add one is for education. We have no control in this example, but you can develop later. You have APCT lag, but it's a starred line. APC lag with age and education you can make use of. Here you have simply the lady APCD to compare the degree to which you observe birth cohort inequalities in the different countries. Here you have a loop on the four different countries we can make use of with ENCODE, SUNISO, so that we know the maximum number of countries we have to count in this loop. And then the complicated thing after is to generate the graphics. Complicated graphics in general go with complicated two files. Econometrics is easier to do than graphics, if you want. But the result is not already on the screen of Lissy. I've forgotten how many minutes we need to do so. But if you observe, if you make the difference between the US, it's without controls, but in the US you have 5% bump for this Vietnam generation you have here. In Finland, you have two small bumps, one for the cohort born in 1945 and one for those born in near to 1975. But in Italy, you have big early baby boomer bump. And in France, you can identify a very strong bump where early baby boomers benefited in the same age group, controlled by the age groups. In the same age group, the early baby boomers systematically benefited from plus 10% income compared to the average. And cohorts born in 1930 and cohorts born in 1970 are systematically below the line. What I don't give to you because we have no time to do so, what you can observe is that you have a small bump in the US, but not so massive. In Canada, you have nothing. In Norway and Finland, you have a small bump for the early baby boomers, but it's relatively residual even compared to the US case. In France, you have a huge bump for early baby boomers born in the 1945, early 1950. In Germany, you have also, but it's not more than in the US. The big cases are France, Spain, and Italy. So this means that maybe it's less a question of corporatist regime than a problem of Latin insider-based societies where Germany was not so extreme in this context. And the funny thing is that in Poland, a bit in Hungary, but it's small. This change is significant, but the gap here is not extreme. In Poland, Sue was born in the middle of the 1960s. And the funny thing is that in Chile, those born in the mid-1960s had been deprived of access to education. Indeed, the explanation of those bumps is low development of education. We observe in those two cases is that there had been a deprived generation who were the 20-somethings of the early 1980s. And General Jaruzelski and General Pinochet in Chile and in Poland had been able to sacrifice on the long range the situation of those born in the early 1960s that had been too young in the context of dictature and too old when dictature finished and the new opportunities for education and jobs had been obtained by other people. We have no time to devote to Gini indexes by age groups and periods, the same kind of calculation. So I skip these two things simply to go to the conclusion. We see that some cohorts are super lucky, typically in general, those born right after the Second World War, the early baby boomer generations. France is extreme, but you see this pattern in many countries. France, Italy, Spain have similar huge differences between lucky generations and unlucky generations. There are strong potential explanations based on welfare regimes or on the interaction between welfare regime and history. See, for instance, Poland and Chile in terms of capacity to be nocive to different generations. But the situation could be complicated. And I will have no time to elaborate on the philosophy of generations. Thanks for your patience. And the next session will be devoted to extreme inequalities through Luxembourg Income Study with other do files to replicate what we observe on the slides. Thank you and see you very soon.